I didn't really know what I wanted to do in life. I was surrounded by people like, yeah, I wanna be a biomedical scientist, and I wanna be a doctor, I wanna be a lawyer, I wanna be a plumber. And I'm like, okay, cool. And they're like, what do you wanna be, Jermaine? And I was like, I don't know. Well, my mom wants me to be a doctor, my dad wants me to play basketball because of my height. But I like music. When everyone was in science, I was at the back of the class, tapping my finger, thinking of different lyrics and melodies. And I knew music and politics was the route that I wanted to go down. From a young age, I've always said that I wanted to change the world. I don't know how, but I wanted to change the world. And I believe that everyone should have the ability to impact the world in a positive way. It's when we allow people to reach their full potential. And this is exactly what NCS is doing. It's equipping you with the tools to reach your full potential. So yeah, back to the voice story. So I was 16, I applied, I was still in college, and what you guys don't see on TV is that you have to go through a certain amount of producers. So you meet with about 3 rounds of producers and then go through an interview, and then you're allowed on TV. So I went through those rounds of producers, they were speaking to me, I was singing to them, and I got through to the last round of interviews, and they said, okay, so you're from Hackney. Are you in any gangs? So I was like, no, I'm actually involved in the youth parliament. I want to be a politician when I'm older, and I'm passionate about raising up my community and getting rid of crime. And I'm like, oh, okay. And I got an email saying that I'm not what they're looking for. Now that really knocked me back. It really did knock me back, because the way they advertised the voice was that if you can sing, you can get in. By me not getting in made me feel like I couldn't sing. So imagine that, being surrounded by all these people who knew what they wanted to do in life, you have that only love for music, and then being told, no, you're not good enough. It really knocked me back, because I said, well, what am I good at then? What am I good at? I didn't really know. So I was down for a while, didn't want to sing, didn't want to go to college anymore. I just thought everything was just a waste of time. But for some reason, I started to believe in myself once again. I started to go back onto the horse and ride it again, doing small little performances here and there. And this is another lesson about grasping every opportunity. If an opportunity comes your way, I'm telling you guys, take it with both hands. I took up every single opportunity, even the small pub performances and cafe performances. And I remember performing for a birthday party, just a small birthday party, about less than, it was about 30 people at the birthday party. It was a small little restaurant. And I was singing, I finished singing. And I don't know if you guys know the Mobile Awards. The Mobile Awards that happened like in October time. The woman who created the Mobiles was there. And she heard me sing. She said, oh my goodness, Jermaine, you're amazing. I want to put you forward for The Voice. So I rolled my eyes, because I'm now 18 at this point. I rolled my eyes and I'm like, yeah, whatever, like, do what you need to do. Because I come from a community where we've been told time and time again, I can do this for you, I can do that for you. But nothing ever materializes. It's all false and broken promises. So when I hear someone come along, someone of Kanye King's stature and status come along and tell me, yeah, I can do this for you, I'm like, okay, cool. Another false and broken promise. She actually pulled through and she put me in front of the judges once again. And I sung, and they enjoyed my performance. And then I got an email saying, congratulations, you made it to the blind auditions. Now, going through that whole entire process, walking on stage, having will.i.am, Tom Jones, Ricky Wilson, and Kylie Minogue back to you, I've never been more nervous in my life. Never. It's a feeling where, like, you're on the scariest ride on a fun fair or in a, like a theme park. The scariest ride. And when the armbands come down and you know there's no turning back, that's how it felt. And it's like, you know what, just brace yourself, force yourself, and go for it. And when will.i.am turned around and he was like, I want you on my team. Oh, I skipped a bit. So when I was 16, right, and I auditioned, well, I was so excited that I had a dream. And this is no word of a lie, I had a dream. And in the dream it said, I was in a line, it was like,
50 odd seals, and Will.i.am was in his like turn off, getting marched up and down the line. And you know when your dreams don't really make sense. So I was standing there, and he stopped and he pointed at me and said, "You're not going to get it this time, but you'll win the second time." So now, applying again when I was 17, when I was 18, never crossed my mind because I'm still in 16 years old. So when I got chosen when I was 18 to do the third series of The Voice, and in Will.i.am turned around, the dream came back into my head. I said, "Oh my goodness, the dream actually came true. He said, I won't get it this time, but I'll win the second time." Not realizing that the dream actually meant that I would win the whole entire competition. That, the voice process was crazy. Because I was 18, one of the youngest in the competitions. You had singers who were 30, 40, 50 years old who had been doing it far longer than I had been born. And they were, this meant so much to them. This is like, this is my life. I want to be singing and I'm not messing around. Me, I was just an 18-year-old, just excited by the fame, the camera, the girls, and the parties, and the clubs. I was just excited to be there. I didn't think much about it. But it was a difficult process. You had to be on your game 100% of the time. My week while I was on the show was crazy. Like, you have to do press in front of papers, and then you have to go to the studio to record the album, to record the song that you're performing for the Saturday night. And Will.i.am tend to change my songs all the time. So I'd have to change the song, record it again, and then rehearse for the live show on Saturday. And I have no social life at all. Your social media, your Twitters, your Facebooks, that doesn't belong to you anymore. You give it to the media team and they run it for you. It's absolutely crazy. It's like a machine. And if you're not ready for that machine, the machine will eat you up and spit you back out. And the reason why I'm talking about my voice story, because it's similar to a lot of young people's lives across the UK. A lot of young people feel like they're out of their depth. They feel like they're facing so much adversities and so much obstacles. They don't know how they're going to overcome it. You know when you're just trying to do so many good things and you're trying to stay positive, but you feel like the tide's just going against you? And you're like, everything's going wrong. And you're like, I want to try and do better for myself. I want to try and achieve greatness. I want to reach my full potential, but there's no opportunities. When there was no opportunities, when I was growing up in Hackney, I created those opportunities. I put on concerts, knew the singers in my local area, I put them on the same stage, met up with my local church, so I want to put on a show. But it's very difficult. But I'm excited to be in a room around you all because I can see future pioneers in your own industries. I can see in your faces. Don't worry, I see a lot of faces on a daily basis. And I see bright and intelligent people. Very skillful people. And it's about connecting that skill with what you're good at and thinking about, okay, how can I use this to earn a living? And it's okay not to know what you're good at, because I didn't know what I was good at, what I wanted to do or what I was good at your age. That's why I kept all my options open. I studied food technology in school. Partly because I got free food as well. I did drama, dance, I couldn't dance to save my life. Who's a dancer here? Who was a dancer? You a dancer? You're a dancer. I couldn't dance to save my life. I did ICT, Spanish and French. Hated languages. I'm better to do English. Then I'm fine with Spanish and French. But it's about keeping your options open because you never know what might come your way. And it's all right not knowing what you're good at. So keep your options open. So when you're moving forward, you're like, okay, cool, actually studied food technology so I can go into catering. Or I studied Spanish so I can go out into Spain and see if they got any like European jobs or entertainment jobs. It's very important to stay positive, stay committed, stay striving. Now, after The Voice, I released an album, did a tour, worked with some amazing people. I've done things that I would never even dream about. For example, teaching Prince Harry the electric slide. I was about to swear. But I was like, teaching Prince Harry. I remember that night so clearly. I was like, there's no security. Not realizing there's plain clothes security guards like just sort of like eagle eyeing me. But yeah, that story to one side. My life has just been a crazy roller coaster, and the images that are projected out from all the winners of the reality TV shows, oh, they're living life, and that was actually very difficult. Very difficult. I'm only 22, but I look about 42, I'm telling you. You have to
constantly learning. And if you want to succeed, you need to be able to work hard. Forget about sleeping, because sleep doesn't exist to me anymore. Sleep to me is just a waste of time, because the same hours that you're sleeping, you could be working hard on a project, thinking about, okay, cool, like, I can design some clothes, or I can buy some plain t-shirts from a store, design it, and I sell it to my friends, or get a top shop going on in my local school. These are the ideas that you need to be thinking about to make yourself stand out. You're already standing out because you're part of the MCS. That in your CV will set you apart from the thousands of other young people in this country trying to go for the same jobs and the same opportunities as you. So congratulations on getting this far. Now I want to talk about the social action project. Do you guys know what you guys are doing yet? Or have you guys had a thought about it?
Well, we're still planning. It's the first day of planning today. So there's a few ideas about it, but I've actually got a social action project yet.
So I can do a Q&A, but I also want to know what affects you. What do you feel like affects you in your local community? Because I remember when I did my local, when I did my social action project, we did it on homelessness in London. And to raise awareness about homelessness, we decided to build a cardboard box, a home out of a cardboard box, and try and fit as many young people as possible into this cardboard box. It was jokes because it started to rain and the cardboard box started to crumble away, but it sent a message to the young people that this is how rough sleepers actually sleep on the street. This is what some people are actually going through. So I want to know what affects you in your local community. What do you feel like resonates with you? Do you see homelessness? Do you see crime? Or what is it? Because this can also help you with your social action.